is Philip, and welcome to my channel. Today we're looking at the art of Disney Pixar, Lightyear, formed by Andrew Stanton, introduction by Angus McLean. Lightyear is a newer Disney movie, only being out like a year or less right now. It's on Disney Plus, also physical media right now. Voiced by Chris Evans, I believe. Lightyear is, of course, Buzz Lightyear from the Toy Story series, but this is before he's a toy, so this is the real human version of the person that the toy is based upon. So, we're gonna look at the art book of this. This is the first Disney art book on this channel. There will be definitely more. I have some more already, ready to be looked at eventually, so if you like Disney stuff, you know, your subscription would be great. But anyway, let's look into the book. We're gonna take off the dust jacket too, so we're gonna do that first, but you can kind of see the dust jacket right there, the little piece of it, and the inside artwork. And we're also gonna see that we got Star Command logo right there, so that's cool. See the whole book right here. So we're gonna look through the art of Lightyear, the art of Disney Pixar Lightyear, formed by Andrew Stanton, introduction by Angus McLean, by Chronicle Books, San Francisco. We got some credit to some artists over here for the front cover, front flap, back flap, and end sheets, and also the pages. Somebody got credit for those too. Copyright of 2022. Looks like we got Buzz over here, and we got the base. We have our table of contents, about a 174 page book. Same picture, but darker or like raining right here. And then forward. This is the only text that I probably am going to read, just because there's a little bit of acknowledgement from like the person who made the book. If you don't really like the reading, or if you don't like my reading exactly, skip like a minute or two and then we can actually look at the art. But here's Buzz. He's got an awesome shield, and he's got like a little saber right here. Very cool. Forward. Wait, what if he repeats his backstory word for word? The room broke into laughter, everyone shouting over one another, trying to pitch the most iconic space creep possible. This is how I remember my first steps of Buzz Lightyear's world being created. The gag of making the toy Buzz utter with a full conviction exactly what was written on the back of his toy packaging once he came to life. That was long ago in 1993, and even though the word meta would not enter the lexicon for another decade, we all knew that we had sparked a conceit bigger than our toy movie Toy Story could hold. The idea kept growing. What if Buzz Lightyear was an action figure from Andy's favorite TV show? What if this show was a Saturday morning cartoon sci-fi adventure series? What if we opened Toy Story with the Buzz Lightyear show at the harrowing climax of an episode and Annie's watching it with his toys. The idea got very far, but ultimately dramatizing Andy's love for Woody before the cowboy doll's world turned upside down became a much more important priority. Still, the genie was out of the box once Buzz's world was tasted. You saw us indulge in it briefly at the beginning of Toy Story 2. All of us wanted an excuse to dive headfirst, 100% into the original world of Buzz Lightyear's character, but no excuse ever came. Until Angus, bless his geek heart. Nearly 20 years later, director Angus MacLean pitched us his private dream of fully experiencing Buzz Lightyear's world. It was inspired for Angus Donnelly. It would be an amalgamation of all our favorite action adventures that formed us. Johnny Quest, Star Wars, Raiders of the Lost Ark, Aliens, but most of all, it would be legit. Man, that amalgamation word is hard. I don't see that word very often. Anyways, Angus drew from a deeper well of details that we had not even considered. Roles, complexities, and relationships that it gave it an air of authenticity all its own. There was nothing silly or deluded about this Buzz or the future he came from. This Buzz was cool. Still adorable, but yes, he kicked ass. A.K.A. Andy, A.K.A. us, would have definitely begged his mom for a Buzz Lightyear action figure from this series. Yup, it was time. Before You is a book chock full of imagery made by some of the most talented artists today that would finally allow you to visit where we would have longed to go for decades. Who knew that Infinity and Beyond would be so apt a statement for the riches Buzz Lightyear's world had in store. Strap in, Space Rangers, and prepare for liftoff. Andrew Stanton, executive producer, and one of Buzz's proud parents. Okay, and then we got the introduction over here, but I'm not gonna read this. If this is something that you're interested in reading, hopefully you can pause the video and see the text. Hopefully it's good enough. Not small. So we got Buzz over here and his cat Socks. I believe the dog thing's name is cat's name is Research. So it looks like this is some of the crew who worked on the movie. Lots of people that makes these kind of movies. Tons and tons of hours go into it. There is also, you know, I assume when they say research, they probably had to go to NASA and stuff like that to learn about space and, you know, whatever. Spaceships and designing it to make it more realistic. Alright. Characters. Look at all these random people from the movie. Of course, we got Buzz over here. Joyce, Jeff Pigeon. So these are different variations by different artists. And they also say like what they used to do it, if it was just pencil or if they did ink and marker, pencil marker, and coach. I don't know what that is. I'm probably not even saying that word right. Some looks like molds of Buzz. It's pretty cool. Buzz Lightyear mold. I always would want like props or whatever from a movie, like all these movies I've seen. I'm like, man, that would be so cool to just have like in the house. Like, but none of these things are ever for consumers because they're just like handmade and they're really high quality. We got, looks like more Buzz. But he looks a lot different in these pictures right here. I like the red suit. Kind of reminds me of Big Hero 6 though. So obviously this is his iconic look right here. So, but there he is, like with like a bigger suit. And he's got like the, or like one without painted as much. Or like first suit. So first act suit montage, second act, third act, and jammies. Flight suit, the red suit. It's very cool. Now to see how many iterations and variations of the same thing they have to do. So, again, more suits of Buzz. So we got the 02, 03, 07, 09, 12, 14, and 15. And it goes from, these are all like digital, looks like. And then more details. So we have his, like, these are like handcuffs right here. We have his arm and the arm, like arm gun. His sword. His sword is one of the coolest parts right here. Of course, they don't give the toy the sword. Like, what the heck? I would want the sword if I had the toy. Got some human variations. This one doesn't even look like Buzz. Or he looks like he's been in the sun for way too long. Because you have very tan Buzz, and you have absolutely pale Buzz down here. Of course, all the artists are accredited, which is very, very important, very good. Here's one of the other characters interacting with Buzz. This is watercolor and pencil, so very awesome. Then we have some, like, stills right here for the movie. Of scenes or concept art of these scenes. Space Ranger Academy with Buzz and the other character. We don't get to see much of Alicia's life while Buzz embarks on his missions, so I came up with some ideas about her grandmother Izzy's upbringing and how her grandmother influenced her. We explored the idea that Izzy was a planet ranger, and that while Buzz always had an aversion to the dangerous planet, Alicia eventually grew to appreciate it and helped her granddaughter learn to admire it as well. So Alicia's the mom, and then Izzy is the granddaughter. We see her at 35, 45, 65, and 75 years old. She aged pretty well. Oh yeah, everybody's favorite character. Little kitty cat. There he is, getting pulled out of the box, and then Buzz is like, whoa, he talks. Got the mouse toy. More computer images of, I think, socks. Got his little bell hanging there. That's a classic poster. Property of Star Command. And then his ID number, his long ID number. There he is. SOX. S-O-X. Now we got Izzy over here. Izzy is a kid wanting to be a ranger herself. Then Izzy and Buzz over here. In the film, Izzy needed to become Buzz Lightyear's best friend. She needed to be full of life and humor and strong where Buzz was weak. She also needed to be very empathetic and someone that could be a teacher to Buzz. All these things had to come across in her design. Thank goodness this is a collaborative art form. All the characters designers in this film helped find our Izzy. She is a result of a lot of thought and care by a lot of friends in the studio from art, all the way to the rest of the production departments. Izzy's character and design is a reflection of many people's efforts, as it suits her well. Matt Nolte, character art and designer. Got some more Izzy right here. This is like, she was like, oh my god, she just looks like super serious right here. It's so different than this right there. Yeah, she looks like hard, Like, she's about to, like, punch you right here. Way too serious. Oh, here. I forgot what this guy's name, but I hopefully they'll say it. This is, like, the one of the other guys. There's, like, three or four other characters, like, that Buzz, you know, interacts with. It's like the grandma that's like on probation or something like that. This is cool. That's a very interesting, like, first design. She almost looks like, you know, very, like, elder, like she should be like a royal or commanding something. Here she looks like more fun. Like, here she's very serious here. This is serious but fun serious. Based on these expressions, too. Okay, we got weapons over here. For a kids movie, this has a lot of weapons. It actually has a lot more weapons than I thought there was, so it's kind of funny. Weapons. It has the list of every single weapon over here. 09 is called the Lollipop Rocket. Where's 9 at? Right here, Lollipop Rocket. Here, all four of them together now, the whole team. Got cartoon, like, hand drawn over here, and then they get the more digital as it goes on. All these are cool. So these are the robots. They call them like Zergs because that's all they say. Michael Fong had this shorthand way of drawing robots. Drawing a Cyclops character in storyboard form, Michael created these Frankenstein elongated bodies that Angus thought would be great for the final character. Dean Heeson, informed by these drawings, would further flesh out the final character design that would later be 3D modeled by Michael Navis. Some more variations of them. Looks like a lot bulkier here, and they end up going a little bit skinnier and taller for these. Oh, here we go. We got Zerg. Of course. This one, I like him more purple, so I'm not a huge fan of this variation of this color palette that they put on him right there. This is more what I think of Zerg. That's Zerg. That's awesome. Oh, sick. These are really cool right here. Got Zerg in his full form, full-fledged up. While working on Zerg, we had a lot of fun getting inspired by our favorite 80s sci-fi and mecha anime. Our aim was to evoke the classic Zerg look while reimagining him into a cooler, meaner, and more imposing villain that would leave Buzz quaking in his space booties. Yeah, he definitely looks awesome. This is like one of the general type character, it looks like. Oh, this guy too. This guy is like, he's like a very minor character, but MVP at the same time. We have more small characters, designs of every little smaller thing. Just some world building characters. Yeah, look at all the characters right here. So they have, you know, the main cast right here. Then they have all these side characters, like, that don't even really have any dialogue, but they all have their unique personalities. We got Mission Control, we have all the flight crew, Cash Salvage Crew, Crash Salvage Crew, Fuel Crew, Ground Support, and then Medical and Command. So many characters are made for this movie. Here's some more side character and design. Looks like this almost looks like police right here. MP. So yeah, maybe military police. Got SWAT right here. Alright, and that's it for the characters. Environments are also just as cool. This movie has a lot of cool places that they visit. Here we go, we got Buzz coming crashing back after doing his loop, trying to get home. We have, looks like Earth right here, but looks kind of like it's almost like dying because it's so brown, but that's just me. We have some more space. These pages are really smooth too. I really like how these feel. We have some places where the initial spot that they landed is, nothing's even built up yet. It's just a desolate planet. We got the classic Buzz Lightyear line where he goes, "There seems to be no intelligent life here." Love that line. It's like just more like a meme from Toy Story. Okay, the vines. The vines are also a good gimmick of this movie. They just yank people every 5 seconds. So this is called Rookie Mistake Part 1. So this is all the storyboards of the movie, or some of them that they concepted, you know, coming down, coming to the planet, you know, making his rookie mistake. Got the vines, see the vines grabbing. I think in the beginning they had like an extra trainee with them, and Buzz like wasn't a fan of that. And here, Rookie Mistake Part 2. So it keeps on going. They got the punches, like all this stuff got hand drawn before even getting animated. So it looks rough, but it gets finished in post. The vines, the green vines being dragged and stuff like that. There's the rookie. It's so cool. We got some of the bug monsters. These guys are not too friendly either. Early on in the film, I was asked to take a design pass at all sorts of alien bugs for a savage planet, Takani Prime. One of the qualities Angus was interested in was balancing both cuteness and scariness in the designs. I tried all sorts of shapes, sizes, and colors, paying close attention to how the scale of the bugs could add to the absurdity and primal fear Buzz and the survivors might experience. I also explored both larval and mature versions of the key bugs, articulating how their mandibles could vary. So they got cute and ugly. And they wanted to look in between. Oh, sick. We got some more. Almost looks like the Death Star, this big ball right here. Got some of the ship area. Very cool. Awesome. We don't see too much red in this movie. We got like a red sun over the landscape over here. And more concept designs of the actual space station right there. Then we have a big highway or big road. Kind of reminds me of like the bridge in Thor or in Asgard. But this is different right here. Not Asgard. Ship is getting about to, you know, leave. They have to open open this door and the ship can go out and fly. Some more wide angle of Star Command. Got the logo right there. Got some doors. Every single door and every single component had to be drawn by somebody. Here's another storyboard section of Buzz going out. He has a crystal right here. This is like their big power core right here. And he needs to charge it, I believe. Or get the correct sequence. So he's got it right here. It gets more rainbow in the movie, but here they show this orange. And then he's ready to prepare and then starts his engine takeoff. This is more of the main area. Here is a liftoff sequence as well. Got Star Command Mission Control. Look at the big screen of everything. At some point, it's like, how do you even see everything if it's so big? Looks like somebody who's in power right here, like a boss, and all the people working together. Oh, this is cool. So this is more like the actual movie itself rather than concept design right here. The holograms needed to convey a dense amount of information while still fitting into Lightyear's retro tech aesthetic. This look is a throwback to the films that inspired us as kids and how they imagined what the future might look like. Nearly all departments were involved, as graphic designers, modelers, shaders, animators, lighters, and compositors worked together to execute Ivan's flight plan. So Ivan is like a machine in his ship, and it, you know, does holograms and stuff like that, very futuristic. Okay, we're at the first mission. Every single step of the way. Unstable. Here's the crystal. Buzz is like, come on, you can do it. And he has to eject. Didn't work. Or, well, he was like ready to eject. First mission continued still. Decides not to eject. And he's like doing some trajectory, some calculations right before he has to decide if he needs to eject or not, or if he can save the ship. Got the fuel power. Does all the calculations right here. I wonder if these are real math equations. I guess it'll say right here. We need a math equation for Buzz to write out in the canopy of the first hyperspeed test mission. My father is a retired mechanical engineer. And I asked him what the math would look like for a spaceship looking to correct its trajectory using an explosive device. A week later, he sent me these equations. For the purpose of the movie, we had to drastically reduce the amount of math featured in the canopy. But this is the spirit of showing your work. Here's a complete equation on the left and the screen used in the version of the right. Wow, so look at all this math right here. That's crazy. Shortened it down to this, but that's still just as complicated. Oh, we got some more. This is my favorite kind of art, like actual space art. Got the crystal right here. These are more finalized for the movie. Phew, has to explode himself to correct the trajectory. Because he couldn't get home until he went through these rings right here. Otherwise, he wouldn't land correctly, and he wouldn't slow down for the planet. So he has to go through these rings, and then he can go fly down into the planet. Welcome back in time dilation. So what happens when he goes up to space is a lot of time passes down here. What seconds for him is years down here. So every time he goes up, he's losing his life, but he's doing it to try and get his friends and his co-workers back home. This almost looks like Wally right here. Got some more ship outer worlds. I like the green right here. This green looks really cool. So just like an overhead view. Because the story was inspired by the changes of my hometown of Portland, Oregon, I had the art team use the physical layout of the city as a starting place for our city. As the story matured, we ended up changing the city plan, but I was always charmed by these early explorations. In order to create the feeling of passage of time, I had to imagine generations of people's lives behind every landscape and the background design I was imagining, like I was a kid playing with Lego bricks. Then I had to project how nature would come back over. It was a very deep, meditative exercise. So we can see that the land is changing over the time. Over time, the trees grow and stuff like that, and it gets more and more advanced over time. We got Pizza Planet. Pizza, and then just Planet. Pizza Planet, of course, is a callback to Toy Story. Some more of Buzz's room and his amazing space meal right here. Got Socks and Buzz. Socks and Buzz again. There's his bed. There's Buzz. 3D model. And then shading is digital, done by separate person. Going again. So, first mission didn't go through. So he has to go back again. Here's the whole sequence of that. Goes up again, and sadly it doesn't go. Alicia grows older and Buzz's frustration mounts. My challenge was to make this contrast entertaining and something that would jump out to the audience. Very true, it does. Here's Socks, you know, working at the computer doing his own calculations. Some awesome got some awesome sunset right here. Socks. Eventually they say we're content with living here, Buzz. We have no more missions, but to Buzz that's not good enough, so he's gotta go out again. But he goes really too fast and looks like he kinda crash lands. Crashlands back on the same planet. Planet that's been taken over by Zerg. It's all run down now. Abandoned, so. You see him coming, he's like, ah, what the heck? And then someone is saying, get down. You have to get down. And then he's like, what the heck is going on here? Oversees the whole land. It's changed. It's not so happy anymore. They got a big overarching alien ship now. Old Izzy. So, this is when he meets Izzy right here. Which is Alicia's granddaughter, or daughter, I guess I should say. It's her daughter. Got some more of the Zerg robots. Chasing their little ship. This is like a digital version, and then another digital version, more detailed, of them going through this craters of fire. And then overlooking the zone right here. This is cool. Very dark, but very cool. So, in space, no one can hear you scream. Got the one light, and that's it. So they can have to navigate with this one single light. Another scene, Zerg attacks. Confronting Zerg with Buzz right here. He runs. Zerg has an awesome, like, armor. He's got, like, the arm. Right there. And then escape. realize these are very, look at the detail of that watch right there. It's just a hand in a circle. More storyboards, escape to continue. This one they actually colored in quite a bit. See all the yellow holes, you can kind of see the difference of what's going on. Got the rocket shooting, hitting the Zergs and blowing up a bunch of them. Stranded, got Socks, Izzy, and then to space. Then I gotta teleport up to space. Face to face. So, confronting Zerg. Here's another Zerg photo right here. We wanted the design of the Zerg environments to be distinct from those of Star Command. The manufactured design of Star Command has a warm, rounded feel with the right angles and asymmetrical details. The Zerg world, in contrast, is robotically symmetrical and features oblique angles and repeated design details. The former is a human world with all the warmth and such, where the latter is a technology cold and alien one. So we've got the little triangle. Alright, vehicles. Can have more ships and stuff like that to look at right here. We got the TRNP-01. It's like their main ship. That they come on. Got all the cars and all the rovers right here. This almost just looks like a basic pickup truck right here with some cool paint on it. My god, they have these awesome 8 wheelers right here. 8 wheelers are cool. Got like a little gun mounted up on it too right there. These almost look like, Lego bricks. So they're just toys right here. Toy concepts of the cars that they were making. This is Lego right here too. That's awesome. Star Command Rover deployments. This one's even more wheels. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 wheeler. Big boy. So that's actually very cool that they did a lot of Legos. Lego building is a hobby that I enjoy mostly because it provides a meditative escape from digital film production. It's an artistic medium that allows for quick prototyping. I use Lego builds to brainstorm the designs for many of the film's vehicles. I'll work out the shapes in a quick Lego model and show them to the art team, who will take these rough sketches, detail them out, and align them to the world of the film. In the end, one of my Eric robotic designs was incorporated into the official Lego sets released for the film. That's so cool. So, he also has to have a pretty big collection, because he has to do everything from scratch, and his own personal items, and each Lego piece. Because there's no sets for the actual movie until the movie comes out and somebody else, like, creates it. Here's some physical prototypes, too. Stuff like this is what I would love to have from a movie. Like, have somebody prototype like something and be like, okay, here you go. Like, get to keep it. Why should studios always, like, keep those and they display them somewhere else? Disney or whoever. Got some more ships. XL-01 overview. Reminds me of Star Wars, which... also reminds me that we need some Star Wars books on this channel. All things come in time. All good things come in time, I guess you should say. SCXO-I5 or 1-5. This is more of Ivan in many iterations. And here's the holograms that they were talking about too from Ivan. So Ivan in the dark, Ivan Day in an actual movie right here. Ivan concepts. Ivan had many different iterations too. It's kind of crazy. More ship design. All these little ships. Somebody had to make every single one of them. And here's the Lego concept of this one right here. They just added a lot more color to it. Got Garrett Taylor again. This almost reminds me of like one of the ships from Halo. But the purple. These are awesome. Lego bricks again. Of this. They substituted a red for purple and they made it a little bit longer and straightforward, but that's a cool prototype. Got the purple one again. I think this is a Zerg ship. The way it looks, it's more robotic and futuristic. You know, Zerg mothership for basic proportions. The back is awesome right there. Style guide. Lightyear needs to work in black and white. Shape language to Lightyear. What are all these? Star Command logo, High Command, population, vehicles, Buzz, and basic construction. So all the logos of Star Command. I think they went with this one right there. And they got all the Buzz iterations, all the people. Buzz environment style notes. So at the Buzz place, they have the round corners, rounded simple shapes, right angles up there. Some sort of humanity with, like, you know, wet floor sign. Versus Zergs, it's sharp shapes, irregular polygons, flush lights and panels, repetition. So they had to make them very different. So here you can see the compare and contrast those two. These are more logos right here. These would be some cool patches or stickers. Warp. Population, propulsion. English is hard sometimes. Star Command logo, time progression, explanation. So here's an old school logo, and it gets simple and simple and simple. Here's the language as well: A B C D E F G H I J K L M N O P Q R S T U V W X Y and Z 0 1 2 3 4 5 6 7 8 9. Futuristic language right here. Awesome. Color script. Wow, there's a lot to look at right here. I kind of wish a lot of these were bigger pictures. But these are all the scenes, a lot of scenes from the movie right here, digitally animated and colored. Complete and ready to go. Very awesome. Out of picture. So I don't know if these things ever made it in. I don't recognize this character at all. There could have been extra characters that they wrote and they just didn't have a use for them, or they didn't fit for what they were trying to do. It happens a lot when stuff gets cut or redone. Got some more mechs. This one is like literally like the one that Ripley uses in Aliens. It's like almost identical. Minor bot variations. Hunter bot. Abandoned sequences. So this is not in the movie at all right here. We got, looks like, some robots fighting each other. Got Buzz looking at the ship, something exploding, somebody sniping something. Abandoned sequences again right here. These ones made a little bit farther. There's Buzz training. Something red beaming, something pulling Buzz. This is awesome because this is stuff that you would not be able to see anywhere else besides the book. Raining Rangers. So there's Buzz like, exploding, getting knocked back with the explosion. Planet Ranger. Buzz Lightyear with a spotlight over the name. Made it into the movie, or if it's very light, maybe it didn't go. This is more of the, like, the hound right here. I don't remember this part, so maybe this is like cut, but this is like a robot dog in Buzz Lightyear universe. acknowledgements, so I won't read this either because it's a lot, but Nicole Castro, Buzz in his apartment, digital. It's a privilege to make animated films at Pixar, as its halls are filled with some of the most talented artists in our industry. From Galen Sussman, producer. Here's like a almost Japanese style art. Lightyear. Like an end page right here. Father. Kind of shooting the robot dog. Feel free to do so. My name is Philip.